Let's look at Psalm chapter 8 today. The main point of this passage is found in verse 1 and repeated again in verse 9. The main idea is that God's name is majestic in all the earth. We see that when a passage states an idea in the beginning and repeats it at the end, that is a sure way to determine a text's main point. The fancy word for this is called an inclusio, and the function of this is to state the main idea, God's name is majestic, and then to describe the majesty of God's name, and then to repeat the main idea again. So again, the main idea is God's name is majestic in all the earth. We see this repeated, we see this stated in the first verse and then repeated again at the end, and everything in between describes the majesty of our God. We see the majesty of God described in two ways in this verse. First, we see that God has established his majestic name, and the idea of majesty means noble, it's high, it's exalted, it's glorious. We see God's glory and majesty established first in the heavens, and second, we see it established on the earth. So in the end of verse 1, we see it established in the heavens, and in verse 2, we see it's established on the earth. The end of verse 1 here about how God establishes his majesty and his glory in the heavens is elaborated in more detail in verse 3. We see that God's name is majestic because he has created the moon. He has created the stars. He has put them in place. And these things are but the works of his fingers. It doesn't even say the works of his hands. These are but the works of his fingers. So when we look at the heavens, we see the glory of our God. And every single person in this earth, when they look to the heavens, they see the glory of God. So the idea here is that God's glory is displayed in his power, and his glory is displayed in his supremacy and his sovereignty. He is supreme over all things. With his fingers, he makes moons and stars. He is sovereign. He has control over everything. He is powerful. But then in verse 2, we see that God's glory is also established. It says here, his strength is established because he uses extraordinary means to care for the world. He uses the weak, babies and infants, to still enemies. Notice how unique our God is. He uses the weak and the vulnerable in this earth to still the powerful. And this too displays the majesty and the glory of God. So just as the heavens, God's glory displayed in the heavens, were elaborated in verse 3, God's glory displayed in the earth is elaborated on in verse 4 and verse 5 through 8. In these verses, we see that God's glory is established by using weak means, namely, he cares for humanity. So we see that the glory of God is on the one hand demonstrated in God's power. He makes the moons and the stars with his fingers. But his glory is also demonstrated in his tender care, his mindfulness of humanity. God uses humanity who is weak, and he crowns us, it says, with glory and honor. So our God, who has all glory, crowns us with glory and honor. How? Because he gives us dominion over all of his creation. So when we look in these verses, we're going to see that God gives us dominion over sheep and oxen, beasts, birds, and fish. So Psalm 8 really is a reflection on Genesis 1, the creation of the world. And we see that in the creation of the world, God displays his glory by showing his power. He creates the moons and the stars with his fingers, but also in his tender care and how he keeps the world going by giving dominion to humanity. So as we think about this passage, I think it'd be helpful for us to take a moment and just describe to one another the majesty of God's name. We've seen that it's closely connected to his glory, and we've seen that his glory is displayed in many ways in this verse. So let's take a moment and let's describe to one another just the majesty of God's name. Let's also reflect on God's care for humanity. We see in this passage that his care leads to him giving us responsibility. His care leads to us being crowned with glory and honor. So let's reflect as a group on God's care for humanity in Psalm 8. But we've also seen God's care in a very specific way in verses 3 through 7 and how God's cared for David. So let's think about how God has, how he cares for humanity in Psalm 8, but also how he has cared for David in Psalms 3 through 7 and how he has cared for you in your life. And finally, how does God's majestic name inform our understanding of glory? When we think about the kings of this world, their glory is often equated to monetary treasures, or perhaps the grandeur of their kingdom. But we see something a little different in Psalm 8. God's glory is connected to something else. So how does God's majestic name inform our understanding of glory? And let's ask one other question, or at least one other discussion point. Notice that David just states a fact that God's name is majestic in all the earth. All the earth. All of humanity sees the majesty of God's name. And this is a very provocative thing to say in a culture that is polytheistic, because in the ancient world, most cultures believed that gods only had dominions over certain territories. But that's not the case of our God. His name reigns supreme and majestic over every name. He doesn't have borders to his majesty. So how does this reality motivate us to live on mission? So I hope you enjoy discussing this psalm together in your small groups today.